Hello and welcome to Inside Edition to discuss national, regional and international issues in depth. Our main focus today will be international efforts to protect child's rights. He will discuss the matter with Vice Chairman of the United Nations Committee on the Rights of the Child, Ms. Amal Al-Dosseri. But first, this report for more.
Childhood is a phase in which the human being is more vulnerable because they have not finished developing physically or mentally. Furthermore, the child requires a particular attention and protection. Child's rights were recognized after the First World War with the adoption of the Declaration of Geneva in 1924. The process of recognition of children's rights continued thanks to the United Nations with the adoption of the Declaration of Children's Rights in 1959. The recognition of the child's interests and rights became real in November 1989 with the adoption of the International Convention on the Rights of the Child, which is the first international legally binding text recognizing all the fundamental rights of the child. The convention and its acceptance by so many countries have heightened recognition of the fundamental human dignity of all children and the urgency of ensuring their well-being and development. The convention makes clear the idea that the basic quality of life should be the rights of all children.
We really found that the data confirms that it's been the worst year for children in a war that's been itself so terrible and that has lasted for so long. For example, we were able to confirm over 650 cases of children who were killed as a result of acts of war inside Syria this year, and 850 children recruited by armed forces and armed groups to fight actively in the conflict.
United Nations International Children's Emergency Fund, the UNICEF, is committed to child protection system, as it defines it as a set of laws, policies, regulations and services needed across all social sectors, especially social welfare, education, health, security and justice, to support prevention and response to protection-related risks. These systems are part of social protection and extend beyond it. At the level of prevention, their aim includes supporting and strengthening families to reduce social exclusion and to lower the risk of separation, violence, and exploitation. Responsibilities are often spread across government agencies with services delivered by local authorities, non-state providers and community groups, making coordination between sectors and levels, including routine referral systems, a necessary component of effective child protection systems. Millions of children are not fully protected. Many of them deal with violence, abuse, neglect, exploitation, exclusion and/or discrimination every day. Such violations limit their chances of surviving, growing, developing, and pursuing their dreams. Any child can be vulnerable to violations in many places, including home. The actual number of children experience violation is not easy to determine. However, it is estimated that 150 million children aged between 5 and 14 are engaged in child labor. Approximately 1.2 million children are trafficked annually. And between 22% and 84% of children between the age of 2 and 14 experience physical punishment at home in 37 countries. Governments, communities, local authorities, and non-governmental organizations, including faith-based and community-based organizations, can help ensure children grow in a family environment. They can make sure that schools and communities protect all children and prevent child maltreatment.
Now joining me here in the studio is Ms. Amal Al-Dosseri. Thank you very much for being with us and taking some time out of your schedule. Now, Ms. Amal, can you tell us more about the Convention on the Rights of the Child and how international community monitor and support the progress of its implementations?
Thank you very much. Allow me first to thank you for having me here today to speak about the Convention on the Rights of the Child. Maybe I should start by introducing the convention itself. The convention was adopted by the General Assembly of the United Nations in November 1989. It entered into force in September 1990. Mm-hmm. And so far, 196 countries have ratified the convention. That makes it the most ratified human rights instrument within the United Nations. All countries in the world have ratified it except for one. Now, why has the General Assembly adopted or thought about this convention for children, I mean? Childhood is considered to be the most vulnerable period of time in the life of a human being. It's because of the age that children at this particular age cannot defend themselves, cannot protect themselves, and cannot enjoy the rights of human beings. So the General Assembly adopted this and asked countries to ratify. Invited them to ratify this convention. Now, when a country ratifies the convention, it is considered as a declaration that this country will put all efforts to put the rights of the child as a priority in its all plans and strategies. So Bahrain has ratified the convention in 1992. And it has, of course, submitted its reports. Now, how to monitor, how do we monitor in the committee the implementation of the convention in state parties? Upon the 44th article of the convention, state parties are invited to report to the committee on how they are putting the implementation of the convention in practice in each country. So within the first 2 years after ratification, they have to report to the committee, and then every 5 years. So the initial report of Bahrain, for example, was submitted a while ago, and it has included all the implementation of all rights enshrined in the convention.
As a committee, are you very hands-on when the monitoring or when these reports are being written?
Oh, definitely.
You guys are always in the field. Is that how it happens?
We are not on the field unless we are invited by a state party to come and observe the situation. But what we do is receive the reports, we study them, and of course we have other information from different United Nations treaty bodies. We have information coming from all sorts of sources, NGOs, civil society. We put all the information together, and then we extend an invitation to the state party to come and have a dialogue, engage with us in a dialogue. So during this dialogue, we discuss what has been done in the state party and what has not been achieved yet. Yes. And we issue our concluding observations and recommendations to this country. We encourage them, we expect the country to take these recommendations seriously and work on its implementation and report about it in the coming periodical report. Perfect. So this is how we monitor.
Also, from your point of view, what are the areas in the Convention on the Rights of the Child that you see now has been most effective, or for instance, you can see the most progress?
It's difficult to say that the Convention is more effective in an area and less effective in another area. It is important to view the convention as a whole entity. The rights in the convention are indivisible. They are one unit. And we have, in our endeavors to implement the convention, we have to have this concept very clear in our mind. What can be less effective than others are the means taken to implement certain right or the rights. It is the measures taken, adopted by a country that may sometimes fail to achieve the designed goal. Sometimes certain measures succeed in implementing a certain right, but at the same time, overlooking another right. Mm-hmm. Maybe this is an example I can give. For example, if we build very sophisticated, high quality schools, but we forget that these schools need to be accessible to all children, yeah, including children with disabilities. And if these wonderful schools are not accessible by this group of children, then we are violating a right. Yeah, yes. So.
Well, one of the things that are also, or that also comes back with the, not the violation per se in rights, but basically the spread of the funds. I mean, as you said, if I have a school for, let's say, 500 children that are refugee children, let's say in a safe country, like Jordan or something like that, but I don't have any kinds of schooling for 1,000 that are another refugee, but because the country is a bit more dangerous there. When it comes to those rights, you know, and who is to say what the child gets, what for rights the child can have or has access to?
Well, as I mentioned at the beginning, when you ratify the convention, then you are declaring to the United Nations, as well as to the rest of the world, that you will put all possible efforts to provide all children with the rights and to protect these rights. So, of course, then it is up to the state party how to tackle the implementation of each right, but then they will have to report on it, and it will be in front of the Committee on the Rights of the Child.
And if any violations in that place happens, or in that scenario happens, they would be going to people like you, the people that monitor.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, great. Well, I would like to congratulate you. We would like to congratulate you on being elected as the Vice President of the Committee on Rights of the Child in the United Nations. It is an indicator that Bahrain is playing a vital role in supporting the efforts of the child's right protection. We see all of the efforts that they have done through the RCO, a lot of the efforts that have been done on also other parties, even private parties, for children. How do you value the support of Bahrain's leadership when it comes to this in this field?
Thank you very much for your kind wishes. Yes, Bahrain is a very small island with relatively very small population. I really am very proud to be part of the committee. I'm happy that I was elected by the General Assembly to serve as a Bahraini expert on the Committee on the Rights of the Child, together with other international very high profile experts from around the world. Of course, this does not come from a void. The realization, the full realization of His Majesty the King, that children and young people are the main drive force of the advancement of Bahrain altogether, has led to plans of action in the ministries of the government led by His Royal Highness Sheikh Khalifa bin Salman Al Khalifa. These efforts have really put Bahrain as it has put Bahrain on the map of international community, and it has also it says that Bahrain really cares about children's rights.
Yes.
So when I was nominated by the Bahrain government, and of course this has been studied, the CVs and everything has been studied by different countries, and I was, you know, honored to be selected or elected as a member. A lot has been achieved in Bahrain, and a lot is being achieved in the protection of children's rights. For example, I can give an example. The Supreme Council for Women, led by Her Royal Highness Sheikh Sibiche bint Ibrahim Al Khalifa, has submitted a proposal, a draft law, that Bahraini women can confer their nationality to their children equally as men, as the fathers, which is a big achievement for Bahrain. Of course, it is being discussed in the parliament, and I hope it will be adopted very soon.
Hopefully. But you yourself, I mean, people don't start off their careers thinking they're going to be in this position. How did you come into this? How did you go into this field?
Well, since 2000, I started my work in the General Organization for Youth and Sports, which is now the Ministry of Youth and Sport. And I was heading the Department of Childhood. And it was then that my love for children and working for young people actually started. I started working on the youth parliament, which is, in fact, child parliament. It is for this age group. And I was very passionate about this program, or the project. And during the preparation process, of course, I was engaged in thorough meetings, activities with young people. And I could see then that they can be a real strength for the country. So maybe it is then that I have started, you know, having this very passionate desire to work with children.
Being part of the Committee on the Rights of the Child, how do you see the progress of child rights protection after the latest meetings of reviewing the reports submitted by different countries?
I have asked myself this question very often, especially during the first 2 years when I started serving in the committee. Are we making any difference? We are really working very hard in our mandate. It is really very demanding. And sometimes you feel frustrated that nothing is really being done. But then looking and reading the previous reports of a given country, I could realize that based on the recommendations, things have actually changed in this country. And of course, to the better, for example, changing legislation, changing laws, which is difficult. And it is the base for the protection of any rights. For example, I can give an example of changing the legislation on in a country where female genital mutilation is very much practiced and legal. And then based on the recommendation of the committee, this practice is not abolished, but it's been criminalized. A new law criminalizing this activity or this conduct.
It took a while.
Took a while. And of course, I mean, this new law is going to change the life of so many young girls who would have otherwise suffered from this harmful practice. So, you know, when we look at such achievements, then we really feel very satisfied. Other things, for example, just a month ago, we managed to intervene and stop the execution of a child in a country. And that was a real, you know, moment that everyone was so happy about. We can also, you know, during intercession, we address state parties, writing them letters, for example. At one point, we had to intervene in a European country because we came to know that they were going to change their laws, one particular law, which could have negative impact on some children, a group of children, category of children. And luckily, we could intervene in the right time, and we managed to stop the adoption of that particular law.
That's great, that's great. When we look at the problems that the world is facing, especially children are facing, there are problems that us adults can't even face. You're talking about the refugee crisis, about famine, we're talking about poverty, and we're talking about literacy coming back, we're talking about disabilities and sicknesses and all that kind of thing. The ongoing refugee crisis is hindering the efforts of protecting children's rights in different countries on various aspects. Can you tell us more about this particular issue and how it's being dealt with?
This is a good question, and it is a sad one. Yes, we are going through a lot, especially when it comes to the war going on in Asia and Africa and in the Middle East in general. The war in Syria, the war in Iraq, in Lebanon, all of this result in violation of children's rights. Yeah. Children, sometimes accompanied, but also unaccompanied children, are fleeing the war-torn, their war-torn countries, seeking refuge in Europe or in other countries outside their homeland.
Yeah.
Maybe I'm sure you have heard and read about the 10,000 unaccompanied children who fled their country, and once entering this destination country in Europe or the transit country, they disappeared. And we know how, what could have happened. I mean, we don't understand, we don't know their whereabouts still. They have vanished, but you can imagine where they have gone and where they have ended. So this is a real challenge to the protection of children's rights internationally. I'm afraid it is not in the hands of the committee to stop it, but we can work hand in hand with other committees in the UN and with the state parties themselves to put a stop or a solution to this problem.
Yes. Ms. Amal, during the report we watched a part of it talking about the famine, about basically a time where where the children don't have food, they're undernourished, they're not strong enough to even wake up from sleep or just, you know, have regular food or move around or play like other children should be doing. The famine problem is not a new one. It's been there for ages. And at the same time, right at the same time, we have on the other side of the world a problem of obesity, where people are dying from obesity or heart problems and everything. Is there this very both sides are just not even at all? How did that happen? How does that get fixed?
Well, this is, unfortunately, it's part of living in this world. Yes, there is famine, and we know the reasons. It's because of environmental issues. But there are also different organizations, international organizations, who provide help to these poverty-stricken countries or famine-stricken countries. It needs more than one effort produced by one single entity. It requires the collaboration of all efforts. It requires understanding, real understanding, and that children should not be in such situations. It's difficult.
Yeah.
I agree with you. It is a very difficult situation that we are faced with. And sometimes we feel so helpless in providing any help to children who are actually dying because they have no food. They don't have enough food to make them live to the next day.
Yes.
But we do count on UNICEF in mobilizing international organizations, and there are thousands of them. We have contact with many of them who are actually working with trafficked children, children used in war conflicts, children who do not have food, who do not have health care. So, I mean, the number would, the casualties would be really much bigger had it not been for the efforts of such organizations.
Actually, the UNICEF would have been my next question to you. The UNICEF does so much when it comes to protecting child's rights, and they put themselves together with organizations such as your own, where you guys really target the problem that is the biggest at that time that will affect other children as well, maybe not just one group, but affect. Tell me how that collaboration happened. What does the UNICEF basically provide or give?
UNICEF is considered as our right arm in the implementation of the convention. We so many times encourage state parties to seek the help of UNICEF in tackling certain issues or in implementing certain rights in their country. Technically, UNICEF has the know-how, if not within the UNICEF offices within the country or the region sometimes, they can seek assistance from international experts to help certain countries in tackling the issues.
They will provide that connection.
They can provide this connection, yes.
Media is an essential tool that can promote supporting child's protection efforts. We've seen this happen a couple of times, even here in Bahrain, where it doesn't mean the protection because there is something happening, but even sometimes things happen behind closed doors people don't know about. And even here in Bahrain for a while, we had advertisements in the street for the number, for the hotline that is specified for child abuse. And then a lot of calls came in. People never thought that would happen. Mm-hmm. But media is an essential tool that can promote supporting child protection efforts and also promote the fact that protecting these efforts is protecting the future. What should written and visual media do, in your opinion, to make this a bigger cause to work for?
Yeah. Before I answer this question, I would really like to congratulate you on the new look and the new content in television, Bahrain television. I think you're in a very good hands with His Excellency Mr. Ali Jumaihi, who has, in fact, done this tremendous work. Yes, as you have rightly mentioned, media is very important. Media can be a big ally or enemy to any cause. It can make things work and happen, and lack of media can actually kill a very good project.
Yes.
In fact, I thank you for having me today because this is very timely. And Bahrain is, as I understood, they are preparing, they are in the process of the preparation of the periodical report.
Yes.
And during this period, there should be a lot of media material on the issues of children because it is part of the raising awareness to all stakeholders, to the family, as you said, the children themselves. Many children do not know their rights. They do not know about the convention. So there should be campaigns, of course, led by the Committee on the Rights of the Child, but also with the help of the television, of the written media, newspapers, booklets, pamphlets, posters in schools, in hospitals, in the police. So media is the ally of any successful project.
Is there something in specific that you see media has maybe forgotten or put to the side when it comes to child protection? Or more things you'd like to see?
Personally, I believe that the voice of children is a very important voice in the promoting and in the protection of their own rights. I don't know how children can actually access media. I cannot see many children in the media. I do not see them expressing their own views. And they are the best people to tell you about what they need. I wonder if you could actually arrange for any activities that involve a lot of...
We could definitely look forward to look to that. And I know that what's important to you is that we put... if we do a program with children about this, the important thing is that we mention equality, dignity, and respect.
Yes.
These are the bases that your institution, your committee basically works on.
Yes.
And how can media implement these three figures with providing something for children and having children speak out?
That's a very good question. We always talk about in the committee what we encourage state parties to do is to provide training for all those who work for children and with children. Yes. And definitely training professionals who are working in the media on children issues should be sensitized with the convention, first of all, but then also with how to deal with children, how to talk to them, how not to intimidate them or lead them. And stating certain, fixed things.
Yeah.
This is very, it can be very tricky. It's not a very straightforward training. It is a specialized training. And in fact, such training should be extended to all those who are working for and with children, like teachers, like in hospitals, the pediatricians, like the police force, the police corps, like judges, lawyers who are handling juvenile issues. So training is actually an important part of the participation of children.
Yes, yes. Now, the problem is a lot of people do not see the extreme effect these things have on children. One of the biggest problems we have in the area is child marriage. We have also, as you mentioned before, we have the mutilation. How are these issues that are usually taboo, how are these issues talked about? How do you bring children and try to help them not to be afraid and talk about their stories? I mean, we've seen a couple of very, very strong young girls that have come out after they got married, 14 years old with two children. She's a child.
Yeah.
How do we target that issue in specific and help children overcome it and use what they have gone through, the abuse, whether it was physical or anything else, they use that abuse to help other people?
Yeah. Yes, you have touched on upon a very sensitive and very unfortunately dominant violation of children, especially within the Muslim countries, if I can say that. Not only Muslim, but developing countries. Child marriage is dominant in so many countries in our area. And one way to stop this is by changing our laws. If the law in a country allows a child under 18 to get married, then of course it's legal.
Yes.
So why not? The first thing is to change the law. And that's what we recommend state parties to do, is to change or adapt their legal, national legislation within the convention. And the convention says that under 18 is a child.
Yes.
And if you allow a child to get married, then you have all the ramification of getting pregnant, as you have just mentioned about the film.
Yeah.
A 14-year-old girl with two kids. So when did she have her first one? This is a disaster on her health, on her education. Of course, she's not going to attend any school.
Even her mental development.
The mental development, the abuse she can receive from her partner, and all of these issues are real violation, very violations that can have lifetime effect.
Yes. Now, in Bahrain, His Majesty the King has a very, very loud voice and clear voice when it comes to children, not only in providing them with the necessities of life like education, food, housing, clothing, but also in protecting them. And that a king puts so much, this magnitude of effort in emphasizing children have to be protected, it means that he knows and he sees that this world for children is not anymore a good one. Mm. So how do we protect the children in Bahrain? How do we protect the children in the GCC from facing the problems that are being seen outside? Mm.
Yes, as you have rightly mentioned, that Our Majesty the King really has stated more than two times at least, I know, the strength of young people, children and young people. He is a very strong advocate to protect these children and to provide them with the necessary tools in order for them to develop to their fullest potential. As I also have just mentioned, that to protect them is to first change our laws. And I know, again, that there is a very good piece of legislation, a draft law is being also discussed within the parliament on juvenile justice. Yeah. This is to replace the old juvenile law. And I think these tools are very important to provide more protection to children. This law, for example, is very progressive. It's one of a kind. It's been developed together with other experts who actually have developed similar laws in very advanced and developed countries. So a lot is being done here in Bahrain for the protection of children.
Yes, we saw that that also the RCO has built up about four schools in a refugee camp in Jordan. The refugees there are mainly from Syrian origin. And the point was that basically, what is it that we can do for these children for them to be normal people or part of the society? Mm. And then the king's initiative was building up these schools. And now we also found that three of the top on Jordan and on these schools are from the schools of His Majesty. Do you think that's a positive step, and what can be done extra in order to promote that?
Yeah, of course, yes. This is a very positive and very kind step from the Kingdom of Bahrain. His Majesty ordered the build of these schools for refugees, which is a very compassionate gesture with other people who are suffering from the lack of facilities, from the lack of protection. And this is not, of course, the first time. We have seen also other facilities being built in Palestine, for example. And of course, this is a very positive thing for Bahrain in its international collaboration.
Well, Ms. Amal, what's coming up for you? What is your next step in your new position and in working with all of these internationally well-recognized associations and organizations that help children?
Well, I have served 4 years on the committee now, and I have been re-elected for another 4 years. So I start the next term in May, coming May. That will be for another 4 years. And I don't see that, I'm thinking beyond this stage now. I'll take it a step at a time. But I'm very passionate about working on this committee.
That's beautiful. Is there anything that you would like to add at this point now before we end?
I would just like again to thank you one more time to have me here. I wish that we can also have more material on children's rights, because I have to say that it is sometimes forgotten to talk about children. Definitely. We talk about human rights in general, but children's rights are very specific, and we have to give it more attention.
I totally agree. I think a show that would talk basically about the different ordeals that children face, and then how to fix them, or for instance, even get the opinions of other people or other countries that basically have dealt with this. Thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you very much.
And thank you very much, Vice Chairperson of the United Nations Committee on the Rights of the Child, Ms. Amal Al-Dosseri, for being with us today. And we would like to thank you for watching, and see you next week in another episode of Inside Edition.